Patrick takes the snap, drops back, lobs it back right corner. Decker! He's got it! Touchdown! Eric Decker scores, and the Jets have won it in overtime!
This is the Jet Take with Ben Blessington and Kyle Fahey.
Hello, guys, and welcome to another installment of the Jet Take. I'm your host for tonight, Kyle Fahey. But I have another host tonight, seeing as Ben is over on his trip in Europe, and I am graced by the presence of Kyle Smith from AFC Bros. So, Kyle, here's your theme song. How you doing tonight, Kyle?
Excellent, Mr. Fahey. Man, that song gets me fired up every time. How's it going?
I'm doing pretty good. You know what? We've gotten all of our key players signed that we need to sign this offseason. Last week, we were ecstatic about Muhammad Wilkerson. And this week, I think we could say that we're very excited about the signing of Ryan Fitzpatrick, who apparently was our quarterback the whole time in the eyes of Todd Bowles in his press conference today. So there's a lot to talk about, and you know what? I think we're just going to hop into it. Kyle, what is your opinion on the Ryan Fitzpatrick signing?
Well, I'll definitely agree with what you said with the former about the, you know, being excited about Muhammad Wilkerson. I don't know a single Jets fan that isn't excited about that. However, you can speak for yourself in terms of being excited about Ryan Fitzpatrick. You know, I've said many times on my show, Kyle, that I do believe that Fitzpatrick is the better option than Geno Smith for this current season, but is he going to elevate you more than one win in the total win-loss column? And I don't think so. I don't think that it makes playoffs. And, you know, honestly, I want to see what we have in Geno Smith, and I kind of was just ready to go into the season not having too much expectations, but just wanting to see him out there, and to me, that would have brought enjoyment to me, and we won't get to see it now, barring injury.
Yeah, I agree. And when I said we were excited, I basically meant all Jets fans because it seems everybody forgot about Geno. But it seems, you know, as soon as I was hopping on the Geno Smith bandwagon, at least for me, Ryan Fitzpatrick gets signed like 3 days later. I'm like, man, I'm kind of upset that we didn't get to see what Geno had because, you know, we saw him making these steps in the offseason, trying to make improvements, working with all of our receivers in the offseason, working with quarterback coaches out in L.A. I mean, he was taking the necessary measurements to become a better quarterback, and I'm kind of upset that we didn't get to see that. But at the same time, I know we got our leader of the locker room, arguably. I don't think there's anybody else who is considered the leader of that locker room as much as he is. He has great chemistry with multiple players on this team, and I think he does give us the best chance to win regardless of how many more wins he gives us. Do I think we'll make the playoffs? Probably not, but I think he gives us the best chance over Geno Smith because he is still an uncertainty.
Yeah, and you bring up an interesting point. You say that he's, you know, one of the most unquestioned leaders, and a lot of people in the media were saying the same thing, particularly the people that back him, such as Manish Mehta. And Manish Mehta went out and said some blasphemous comments saying that, you know, he's now the best quarterback in the AFC East for the first month of the season. I mean, give me a break. He's not better than Tyrod. He's not better than Ryan Tannehill.
No.
Not even close,
it's
in my
arguable
opinion. And, you know, I mean, here's what I think about leadership. The fact of the matter is Ryan Fitzpatrick has one winning season in his entire career. Count it, one. And he's been in the league for 10 years. He started many, many, many games. He's probably lost almost double the amount of games that he's won. And I think that one of the big reasons why so many people in the locker room liked him and loved him was because the Jets were winning. There wasn't any particular point in last season where the Jets had a losing record. They were at worst 500 when they were 5-5. But they were always winning. And there's a difference. When you're winning, things are good and everything. But when you're losing, it's a different story. And leadership isn't just, you know, how you handle yourself in the locker room. And there's no doubt Fitzpatrick does some great things. Like, you know, Brandon Marshall would say things like, you know, I'm out to dinner and I'm getting texts from Ryan Fitzpatrick where, you know, he wants to run this play in this way. And, you know, that's great. That's infectious. But leadership is also what you do on the field. And that's why I question Ryan Fitzpatrick. Makes some boneheaded moves every now and then. Doesn't have great ability in terms of arm strength and things like that. And if losses start to pile up, you start to go three games below 500, you know, will people be looking to you for leadership at that point?
Yep. Yeah, I agree. I mean, that's really the whole reason Fitzpatrick got the how would I describe this? Funk, I would want to say. Like, he's got that certain funk to him. This was really the first time a lot of those players had won. Besides Nick Mangold and last year DeFinkishaw Ferguson and Revis, who got to those AFC Championship games, guys on that team, at least when they were with the Jets, like Eric Decker, Chris Ivory, Bilal Powell, Brian Winters, names go on and on, people who have been on our roster, they haven't really won anything significant. I mean, most of them hadn't been to the AFC Championship game. The majority of them bared through 4-12 and 8-8 with Rex Ryan. You know, they come in with Ryan Fitzpatrick and Todd Bowles and Mike Maccagnan. They're making splashy moves in the offseason. They're wheeling and dealing these contracts. And you know what? It got us to 10-6, and we barely missed the playoffs because we choked when it mattered the most. Not Ryan Fitzpatrick. The whole team choked when it mattered the most. So I think that's why Ryan Fitzpatrick has his chemistry. And no matter really how you obtain the chemistry throughout the locker room, is it a bad thing how you obtain it as long as you have it? That would be my counterargument to that. Now, granted, if we start losing, I think that will go away very quickly. But I still think Ryan Fitzpatrick has the integrity and veteran leadership within him to lead this team with tons of chemistry and tons of spunk, as I would call it.
Yeah, and Kyle, I mean, you make my point for me, basically. I mean, you think about who are the leaders on this team. You think of maybe Calvin Pryor on defense, someone like that. Think of Muhammad Wilkerson. Muhammad Wilkerson's never been to the playoffs. Calvin Pryor, his first year, he won four games. Brandon Marshall, never been to the playoffs in his 10-year career. Eric Decker, well, yes, he had a great tenure with the Denver Broncos, and you know, he made it to the Super Bowl. But think about his first year with the Jets. You know, he knew when he was signing that contract that, the Jets weren't a great team. He wasn't coming into a great situation. He took the Jets because of the amount of money they were offering him. But they went 4-12 in his first year. And then you think about the offense, guys like DeBrickashaw, Mangold. Those guys haven't been in the playoffs in 5 years. It wasn't since 2010. So, you know, I think one of the ways they look at it is Fitzpatrick came in and he got us our first winning season in a half a decade. So I think that plays a big role into it. But when you look at this early schedule, it's not unrealistic to say that the Jets could potentially go 0-3. You know, they got Cincinnati, which Cincinnati wins 10 games every year, right? Thursday out in Buffalo. That's a Thursday night game. You're on the road. You have to travel really quick. Thursday teams on Thursday night football, the road team has a terrible record. Then week three, you're going to Kansas City. That is one of the loudest places to play. We all know how good that team was last year, reeling off 10 in a row. It's a really good team. So it's not crazy to say the Jets could open up 0-3. And then let's say Fitz plays poorly in that. You know, everyone's like to say, oh, well, you know, signing Fitz, at least the QB drama ends. Well, will it end if at that point you're 0-3 and Ryan Fitzpatrick has, you know, a higher interception to touchdown ratio? So it's just food for thought.
Yeah, that's definitely true. I don't think we would lose a lot of those games. This personally is my opinion. I think mainly because it's 9/11, unfortunately. That stadium for the Jets, you want to talk about Arrowhead? Have you been to MetLife Stadium on 9/11? I mean, this is the day that everybody in the nation comes together as Americans, and it's in New York, the main primary part of it. And then the Bengals just got very unfortunate in their timing to play the Jets, especially on the home opener. I think the last time the home opener was on 9/11 was against the Cowboys back in 2011, I want to say. So something around there. And they've lost a lot of talent through free agency, suspension, and injury. Tyler Eifert, arguably their second-best player behind A.J. Green, in my opinion. He's more than likely going to be out with that ankle-slash-leg injury. Probably will be out for week two as well. And that was something that we really had to look forward to those matchups with De'Ron Lee and Tyler Eifert. And I was kind of upset about that we're not going to be able to see that. Marvin Jones, they lost him in free agency. He was their number two wide receiver. They also lost Mohamed Sanu, who was, you know, their 2/3. I don't know what you want to call them because I don't know exactly where they played, but they were their 2 and 3 on the depth chart. You lost them the free agency. You're losing Tyler Eifert to injury. You're left with A.J. Green, who honestly is going to take a trip to Revis Island. I mean, there's nobody else really to cover on that team, at least on offense. Then you look at defense. Vontaze Burfict, who is arguably their best linebacker, I believe is out for 4 games in total, or maybe 2 games, for the dirty hit in the playoff game last year. And I believe Adam Jones is suspended too. I mean, they've lost a lot of talent, and I think the Jets are going to capitalize on what day it is and, you know, them not having the talent. And then you look at Buffalo. I could possibly see that as a revenge game. Do I think we're going to win it? Probably not, but I think it's one of those games like last year. It's going to probably be 22-17. We'll be in the fourth quarter, and something will go wrong or something won't go our way. But I think we could win it. So I think we'll at least win one or two of those 3 games. Kansas City, I have as a loss in my book. That's just too hard in an Arrowhead. I mean, Alex Smith would have to go down for us to lose that, or I'm sorry, to win that. But I don't know about 0-3.
Yeah, I mean, I'm with you. I don't think if I had to, you know, guess, would the Jets go 0-3, you know, I wouldn't think that they would. But I'm just saying it's not crazy. It's not unfathomable. It's at least a decent possibility. I'm just putting that out there. And my whole point just by saying that is, you know, winning has a strange thing in the NFL. Things change so quickly. You could be the guy, you could be the man one day, and all of a sudden you start losing, and people turn on you quick. Fan bases turn on you quick as well. So, yeah, right now Fitz is the man, but I'm just saying. So anyway,
yep.
I mean, we could go on and on about my dislike for Fitz. I mean, I appreciate what he did. I would take him as a backup any day, but I don't like the fact that, you know, he tried to suck the Jets out of every last dime, that he wasn't really working out in the offseason as a result, that he came in out of shape because he tried to squeeze a couple extra dollars. And, yeah, I mean, in a sense, I can see why he would do it. It's a business. You only have a limited amount of time to play. But, I mean, no one else was offering him anything. So, I just want to see what Geno can do. But anyway, I've said what I need to say about him. I could say much more, but I'll leave it at that.
Okay, well, I'll just continue on this because I was going to go to another part of it anyway. Do you think the Jets' case for Ryan Fitzpatrick, do you think they were legitimately worried about Geno Smith being their starting quarterback? So they caved in on Ryan Fitzpatrick and gave him what he thought was acceptable.
I do think they caved, yeah, for sure. The reality is we were hearing these reports, and Fitzpatrick went out and said it when he signed that, you know, he was liking the way that the process was going initially when everything was under closed doors, and then he became, you know, angered once things went public. And then you started to hear all these numbers out there. And we had heard this number for a while now that the Jets wanted to give him $12 million in the first year, but then have two extra years tacked on, a 3-year total deal, to which Ryan Fitzpatrick had no interest in, to which he countered and said, I'll do 1 year, $12 million, no problem. And to which the Jets said, we are not interested in that. But lo and behold, they were interested in it right on the eve of training camp. So I definitely do think that they were nervous about having Geno Smith. And let me just say this. I think one of the biggest reasons why they want Ryan Fitzpatrick for this season is to mentor Christian Hackenberg. One thing you can't take away from Fitzpatrick is he knows his stuff. He knows Chan Gailey's system. He is, at the very least, a professional and a heavy student of the game. Make no bones about it. When you draft Christian Hackenberg in the second round, 51st overall, you are viewing him as the future. And to me, that's the most positive thing that I look at out of the signing, is that you're going to have a guy that can be a positive influence and a positive mentor to Christian Hackenberg. That's the most I take out of this. So I do think that the Jets got nervous in Cave, but I will also say this. You know, my brother, you know, he's a big Jets hater. You all know that. He's a big Buffalo Bills fan. And he went out and said that Fitz got what he wanted, to which I said, somewhat. He somewhat got what he wanted. Fitzpatrick wanted Sam Bradford money at the start of free agency. And my brother's on the record for saying it makes sense that he would want that. Fitzpatrick's going and looking at the situation like, Sam Bradford's never had a winning season. He's never made it to the playoffs. You know, I just brought this team to 10-6, and I threw a whole lot of more touchdowns than Sam Bradford. And by the way, I don't get as injured as often as he does. I should get at least the same amount that he's getting. So it makes sense, and this is what he wanted initially, right? There are reporters that back it up. Daryl Slater was quoting Jeff Darlington, etc. So that's what he wanted initially. Now, if the Jets were scared, if they were scared that someone else, for example, the Denver Broncos was going to go and scoop Ryan Fitzpatrick up, they would have given him what he wanted initially, $18 million. However, they held firm, they knew the market, they weren't scared, they weren't intimidated, and they dragged it out through this entire process, but they did cave at the end. So yes, Fitz somewhat got what he wanted, but he somewhat didn't get what he wanted either. At the outset, he wanted much more than what he got.
All right, with that, I think we got to bring on our first caller of the night, and our first caller of the night is going to be the man from down under. Sean, you are on. Welcome, my man. Sean, are you there?
Sean.
Again. See, it's that overseas connection that he has. He's all the way down in Australia, and he has a hard time connecting. Like, me and Meg will see his calls constantly go out, but nonetheless, we got tons of other callers. So,
what time? By the way, Kyle, do you know what time it is down in Australia right now?
Too late. Too late. Probably sometime early in the morning.
Props to Sean. He's a diehard, man, for sure.
Yeah, he has his own podcast of his own, I believe. But we're going to go on to our next caller, and that is Tyler. Tyler, you're on the air, man. Thanks for coming on.
Hey.
Hey, Tyler, how's it going?
Good. I just can't see it there, but what's up?
Say that again, Tyler?
I was getting pizza, but it's all right. What's up, man?
Not too much, man. Just hosting the Jet Take. Really excited for this one. You know, it's interesting. The Jets are my passion. Naturally, when I go to look for news, the Jets are my go-to team because that's the team I root for. And it's interesting to be hosting a show that is just about one team that is my passion. So I'm excited. But anyway, Tyler, what's on your mind, my dude?
I've been doing predictions on the Jets, what the record should be.
All right.
And go ahead.
We can do that.
I was thinking, like, They should be like a 9-7 unless they like kick butt and go like 11-5, but I don't know.
Okay, well that's a fair total. I personally have them going 10-6 to 11-5, depending on that Seattle game, which I think will be hard. I think we could win, but I also think Russell Wilson is an amazing quarterback, can do a lot of things. Kyle, I believe you have us going 8-8. Why so?
That's correct, and I'm actually shocked to hear you say, Mr. Fahey, that they're going to go 10-6 or 11-5 because, you know, you call into our show quite frequently, and I always thought that you were of the opinion that the Jets weren't going to make the playoffs this year. But I'm sorry, my friend. Most of the times when you go 10-6 or 11-5, it's almost a guaranteed playoff victory. I know that wasn't the case last year, but it usually is the case.
Well, the way I'm looking at it right now, I'm seeing teams like the Ravens and Steelers being in the same division. Only one of them can win their division. So one of them's got to claim a wild card. Then you also got to throw in Denver and Kansas City. So one of them will win their division. So I think there would be too many teams who have similar records. And if we lose against the Ravens or against the Steelers or against the Chiefs, because we play them all, we'll probably end up missing the playoffs again. So, Tyler, specifically, I don't want if you want to go like game by game, but can you highlight some key games that we win or lose?
Sure, if I can find it. Hang on. All right. Break down the schedule. Week one. I see the Jets winning.
How about the?
I'm sorry, Kyle. Go ahead.
What do you have the Jets doing in the Patriots game on Christmas Eve? I believe that's in Foxborough.
Week 16?
Yes, I believe so.
You know, it's New England, and I think the Jets are going to lose that, to be honest with you.
Yeah, I would agree there. I think it's going to ruin my Christmas. Kyle, what's your take?
I mean, with that game, I mean, think about it. The Jets don't win in New England that often. I mean, most teams don't win in New England. Buffalo, in the entire Brady-Belichick era, has won once in New England, and that was when Jimmy Garoppolo was playing the majority of the game. Miami almost never wins there. I mean, teams don't win there. Even divisional teams don't win there. We won once in overtime, but that was the Matt Castle season, and Brett Favre was the quarterback. And we cannot forget the best Jets game that we've all witnessed was the 2010 Jets playoff game. But other than that, the Jets don't win in New England. It just doesn't happen. So if I'm a betting man, I got to say that New England would take that one.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, I would agree. All right, how about week one against Cincinnati on 9/11?
You know, it's week one, season opener, so I think the Jets will win.
I definitely agree with you there. How about Seattle? Seattle comes to us. It's week four, I believe. Don't hold me to that. We come off of playing Kansas City in Kansas City, so I believe that's also a different time zone for us. I believe that's considered Central Time. So, do you think Seattle coming to us, do you think we can get that done, or do you think they're just too much to handle?
The Seattle game?
Do you think Seattle will be too much to handle?
In some ways, yeah. Richard Sherman, Russell Wilson, yep. It's going to be a loss.
Yeah, I think I agree. That's where, for me, it wavers between 10-6 and 11-5. I think we can beat a team like Seattle, but at the same time, I know they have a bunch of savvy veterans and a really good secondary. But you look at their offensive line, it's not very good. I think the Jets' defensive line can expose that. But we'll carry on. What about Monday Night Football against the Arizona Cardinals? And I believe that is week six.
Arizona. It could go either way, but I give it a loss.
Do you want to say why it's a loss? Are they just a better team? Like,
let's see. They got Larry Fitzpatrick. What's his name? Fitzgerald?
Yes, Fitzgerald.
Carson Palmer?
Correct.
No idea what their defense is.
It's a pretty decent defense. I don't know if Tyrann Mathieu will be healthy by then, but if he is, he definitely won't be 100%. They have Patrick Peterson, and I believe they just acquired Chandler Jones from the Patriots earlier this year.
It's going to be a close game, but I'm giving it a loss. Next question.
Yeah, unfortunately, just looking at the schedule and seeing which games, what do you think the best game of the year will be for the Jets?
Our best game of the year, like this year?
The best game of the year for the Jets, like the best matchup, like, last year, it was the Patriots-Jets game that went into overtime and Decker and Fitz touchdown. What do you think
will
be this
there.
Year?
This year, let's see. Regardless of who's quarterback,
it's going to be Fitzpatrick. We signed Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Rams, the Browns, I don't know.
Okay, those will probably be easier wins, so it will probably be more memorable because we beat up on them. Tyler, thanks for calling in. Any last things you want to say before you go?
My Twitter intake is TJTank896. You can follow me. And I'm out. See you guys.
All right. Well, thanks to Tyler for calling in there. And, you know, I just want to talk on what he said there before we go to the next caller. Personally, I think the most memorable game this year will be against the Buffalo Bills in Week 17. That's kind of a revenge game for me. Well, you know what? I'll just pick this up with our next caller. And that is our man, Sean. Sean, you're on, man.
Sean, can you hear us?
Not again. Sean. Oh, man, this happens
It's the international calling, man.
It's the international calling, man. We're not even picking up the sound. This is terrible. All right, I'm not going to drop him. I'm just going to leave it on mute. So we'll just go to our next caller.
Hey, listen, Sean's probably in the Outback, and they don't got too many telephone lines out there.
Hold on, I think we got his sound back. Sean, are you there?
Call back, man. Sean.
Yeah. No, I'm going to keep him on. If he starts talking, I'll see. So we're just going to go to our next caller, and that's our good friend, Rumi. Rumi, you're on the Jet Take. What's up?
Hi, Kyle. How are you, both Kyle?
Hi, Rumi. Nice to finally speak.
Right. I'm so excited. We got Fitz on board. I've been a long believer ever since the draft. And I'm excited to have it with Joe, too.
Yeah, you have been one of the only people on Twitter that has consistently said,
sign
Ryan Fitzpatrick at all costs. And you know what?
Right?
We did, because we're down big time in cap space.
That is true.
Props to you, Rumi, for that, for sticking with a person through thick and thin. Because I will tell you this, many fans, you know, it's so interesting. If you've been following Joe Caparoso at Turn on the Jets, he's been doing all these Twitter polls. Who are you with, Gino or Fitz? And, you know, everyone was Fitz at the outset of free agency. Then people turned to Gino, and then once Fitz signed, they're back on Fitz's bandwagon.
See, no, I don't go on the bandwagon. I stick to my guns, even though I get insulted. Even Tyson made fun of me. Because I don't know if you remember that last call I had with him. I mentioned how, like, Rex Ryan, he doesn't want Fitzpatrick to get re-signed and everything. He made a public announcement. And he's like, well, you know, they beat us twice. And I forgot to tell him, but we had the winning record. We had a better record in the end. He was jealous of that. We had a shot at the playoffs. They didn't. So, yes, they did beat us. However, we were in the better situation.
Yeah, I mean,
that's
one thing you could say
is
Rex has a very good record against Fitzpatrick. He only lost to him once, which was at the end of the disastrous 2012 season where Mark Sanchez was tossing pick sixes up in Buffalo.
Yeah.
It's interesting that Rex would say that because he's got such a good record against him. But, there's no doubt that he was jealous of the Jets going 10-6. You know, he made more guarantees last year, said that the Bills were going to the playoffs. So, you know, it was hard for him to stomach that. But you best believe that he got enjoyment out of ending the Jets season.
Yes. Well, you know, it's always the saying. They always got the team that has nothing to lose has everything to gain. I mean, I can go back to – I even brought that game up where, you know, UCLA actually beat USC when they're undefeated. And nobody actually believed that UCLA was going to win that game. Guess what? I actually was probably the only one in LA who actually thought and believed that they were going to win it. And I actually won a bet on one of my old coworkers, and he had to give me that – well, I actually won a dinner. And I got to decorate his cubicle with UCLA Bears and all the stickers and everything. No, but I want to talk to you guys about this schedule. I think the Jets can be 11-5. I have it down here with the wins and the losses here.
Okay, go ahead. Run through it.
So I got the Bengals as a win because it's going to be a home opener and, you know, the 9-11 whole thing. And Andy Dalton's going to be back. I don't even know if he's good. He was injured last year because, you know, A.J. McCarron took over. So we have a win. We have the win against the Bills. It'll be a revenge game. That's Thursday night football. I still think we can do it. We got the Chiefs as a loss because, you know, playing there is really hard. The fan base is crazy over there. They're always dressed in red. And I have the Seahawks as a win. Steelers loss because we always – I don't know why we can't win over there. That just drives me crazy with the rally, the towel, terrible towels. They seem to have a number. Okay, that's a loss. Cardinals a win. Ravens a win. Browns win. That was easy. Dolphins, you know what? At Dolphins, I have a loss. I don't know why for some reason. I know. I have to. I mean, I was thinking about winning.
It's a divisional game.
Five in a row, huh?
It's a divisional game. You know, division games are always tough.
Okay, and then I got the Rams win. That's easy. Patriots, I have them us winning because it's going to be at home. The Colts a win. 49ers, that's easy. That's a win. I'm going to go to that game. And Dolphins a win because it's going to be played at home. And then at Patriots a loss and Bills a loss. So that's 11-5.
All right. Well, I do think that the Jets can win the Bengals game. A lot of the things that Kyle pointed out say that, you know, okay, we can win that game. If Tyler Eifert is indeed injured, I mean, he was so good last year. Vontaze Burfict, one of their best players on defense, he's going to be out because of the suspension. Andy Dalton's going to be fine. It was a thumb injury. I mean, had the Bengals won that playoff game, I bet you Dalton would have been starting the next week. So he'll be fine, totally recovered from that injury, but it's going to be a tough game. In Buffalo, this is hard because, you know, Thursday night games, the road team has a terrible record because you don't have much time to prepare and then make the flight and all that kind of stuff. So that one's tough. Seattle, it's great that it's a home game for the Jets because it's so hard to play over there, and it's hard for West Coast teams to play on the East Coast.
Okay,
but
well,
I think you're also
– Yeah, but then I have the Bills us losing at home at the last game.
Okay.
I could easily switch that.
But what about the Cardinals? You think that the Jets, I mean, in Arizona, that's a tough game.
No, I think we can do it. Because that's Todd Bowles' old team. I think he's going to be pumped for that one.
All right, but to play devil's advocate, Rumi.
That could be a loss. Okay, and that'll be like, what, 10-6 then?
Yeah, I mean, if you want to look at it like this, is I don't know too much about the Arizona defensive coordinator. I do think he was the heir apparent to Todd Bowles, so he might have learned under him. So you could look at it like, okay, well, I know the inside to all Todd Bowles' schemes, so here's what he likes to do on defense, and here's how we can exploit it. Because Todd Bowles was always reporting to Bruce Arians, okay, we're going to expose them this way. And Bruce Arians also knows about that being an offensive guy, so he might know how to exploit those things. It's just a really good team, though.
Monday night, though, I think we're going to do well on Monday night. I don't think we do really well on Thursday night, our record, but I noticed on Monday night we do better for some reason.
It's a fair point. We did only we ran the ball like 60 times against the Dolphins a couple years ago on Monday night?
Yeah, Monday night, for some reason, we seem to win. So that's why I did that, too.
I would say overall we're pretty good on Monday night, but let me bring up two instances to you. 2010, we lost 45-3 to the Patriots on Monday night, and what was it, the 2014 or 2013 season? I think it was 2014 when we were 4-12. The Bears was 2014, so maybe it was 2013, maybe it was 2014 as well. We played the Dolphins, and Rex was so scared of Geno Smith throwing the ball, so he only passed the ball like 5-6 times in that game. It was crazy.
That's true.
Yep.
I still think they won that one.
In Rumi's defense, our good friends over at NYJetsFans.com, go check them out. All right, there's their shout out for tonight. All their buddies and the L7 crew, I believe.
Yeah, they're all
going to
be there too.
They're going to be over there. Yeah, they're all going to be there. It's going to be like the Dallas game. And I'll tell you what, that definitely made a difference in that Dallas game. I will not kid you. I heard them doing the Jets chant at some point in that game on the television. I think that can make a huge difference in Arizona.
I
think
so, too.
When our fans actually travel somewhere. I mean, it's rare enough they show up to our stadium, but when they go to another stadium, I think that's just great. And I think that game will be close, regardless of where it is, because I think we're equal teams. I think they got the advantage at the quarterback position, and I think that's about it. Maybe secondary. I don't know how they're looking, and I don't know if Tyrann Mathieu will be healthy for them. Patrick Peterson and Darrell Revis, I consider them about equal. Maybe I give Patrick Peterson a little bit of the leg up because he's younger and faster. But besides that, the quarterback and secondary, I think the Jets are better in almost every aspect. David Johnson is coming around, but besides him, I mean, you really got nothing. Bruce Ellington, is he still even with the team? I'd rather take Matt Forte, Bilal Powell, and Kyrie Robinson than David Johnson.
We got two Monday nights,
We
got two Monday night games.
We have to play the Colts. We have to
play
the Colts.
So then I have that as a win, too.
Yeah, I think that will definitely be a win. Because we beat them at least the only point in their year last season
when
they were healthy.
That's true.
Yeah.
Come on, Kyle. The other Kyle.
I think
Kyle.
The only.
I think you guys are under. I think you guys are underselling Arizona. I mean, listen, they have a really good receiving core. They're 1-2 is not as good as Marshall and Decker, but Fitzgerald is he's going to be a Hall of Famer. Michael Floyd, he's a good player. He's going to cash in big money in free agency. And then John Brown is an excellent three. That's a great receiving core right there. And then let's not be Carson Palmer. He was, for the majority of last season, he was the number one Pro Football Focus rated quarterback, and he was their MVP. This guy is a good quarterback. And then their offensive line.
But that's about it.
Offensive line is much better than the Jets.
But our defense is going to crush
them,
though.
Okay, we'll throw in the offensive line.
Our defense is going to crush them.
I hope so.
I don't know about that. I still think
I think so. We're
going to
be a top three defense, not top five, for sure.
I could agree with that, because I think even the secondary has improved. Because I think Dee Milner and Justin Burris, I think they'll stand out this year. Justin Burris is the type of guy that you want in Todd Bowles' system. I have famously and stupidly compared him to Patrick Peterson. So it will be fun to see him going up in Arizona. Now, Rumi, before we let you go ahead and give us all your
Twitter
and Instagram and
I wanted to say one more thing. Sorry, real fast. I was watching something on NFL Network. It was so funny. I don't know if you guys caught it. There was this one guy. I forgot his name. He was saying that our roster is a Super Bowl caliber roster without Geno. I mean, with Geno or without Geno and with Fitzpatrick. I thought that was kind of interesting. I don't know who.
Oh,
I forgot that guy's name. Yeah, I have to figure that out.
You take the quarterback away from the Jets. You take the quarterback away from the Jets, and you give us somebody. Think of a mediocre quarterback who can get the job done, besides Ryan Fitzpatrick. I mean, I'll take Tyrod Taylor for an example. I don't think he's mediocre. I think he's above average, and he has a good scheme right now. But I think if you gave us Tyrod Taylor, who I would take over Ryan Fitzpatrick, I think this
would
like maybe
Carr.
The Super Bowl champion.
Derek Carr.
Very young talent. Don't even get me started with Derek Carr, because I was so angry when we passed on him.
I know.
He was so much better than everybody in that draft class.
I agree.
Also passed on Teddy Bridgewater, just saying.
But Derek Carr, though, that really hurt.
Yeah.
Okay,
right,
I don't want to take
so
up too much of your
go.
Time. Okay, my Twitter handle is RKLoveJets, and thank you guys for having me on. Great talking to you.
Thanks, Rumi. Appreciate it.
Bye-bye.
Thanks for being on. All right, so that was a great call from Rumi. I think we're going to go ahead, and I think Sean is back on the line. I really hope it works this time. He's been trying to call in. Apparently, he's using some sort of online thing to talk internationally, so we'll try it again. Sean, are you there?
Hi, guys. How are you?
There we go.
Oh, yes. There we go. All right, Sean.
Hey.
Third or fourth.
Third time's a charm.
Yeah. Definitely, man. What time is it over there?
It's 10:30 in the morning on Friday.
Oh, that's not bad.
Okay, so I'm 14 hours ahead of you.
Wow.
Yeah, so we caught you for your morning Joe and Mickey D's breakfast. I don't know what you guys have over there for breakfast, but we'll just hop right into it. What is your opinion on the Ryan Fitzpatrick signing?
Happy that it got done. Clearly for the locker room more than anything else, because it's clearly, you can clearly notice, social media posts from Brandon Marshall, look at that photo that they put up,
That's a great photo.
Pardon me. Todd Bowles is clearly happy to have him back. He's a leader in the locker room. I agree with a couple of calls ago, he's the closest we've got in the locker room to, like that Tom Brady kind of leader, that out and out, leader who they look towards. I feel for Gino a little bit, but hey, that's going to happen. Todd said in his press conference today, it's just like anything. Hey, like when Gino had that injury last year, obviously it was 95% out of his control. Fitz made the most of his opportunities, and just a quiet 31 touchdown season, you know. So he definitely deserves the first choice. He definitely deserves the first go to be the starter.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And Sean, I find it interesting. I believe you said you felt kind of sorry for Geno Smith, and I was taking the notes today for Todd Bowles press conference because I got a lot of time on my hands and really have nothing to do. This is what Todd Bowles said. He said that he doesn't necessarily feel for Geno Smith. There are a lot of players playing second string, that opportunities come all the time, injuries happen. And then, you know, he later on said, at least the way I interpret this wasn't exactly what he said. Fitzpatrick was basically the quarterback the whole time. Geno knew this, that if he was signed, he was going to be the starter, that he basically told him, Fitz earned it, you are our number two. And then he said having two good quarterbacks is not a bad thing. So it's not like they're discrediting Geno for not putting in the work. It's basically saying that Fitzpatrick has earned this based off of last year, set tons of career records, tons of franchise records, and his own career records. He broke almost every single one of them. So my argument to that would be we haven't had a quarterback that has ever played in the passing era. I mean, you could argue Chad Pennington, maybe Benny Testaverde, but still, I wouldn't consider them a franchise quarterback. They had a couple good years. So Fitzpatrick definitely earned it. I love the effort Geno put in this offseason. I would have loved to have seen him play. But I'm basically on the same page with Todd Bowles. Fitz earned this starting job, even though I would like to see what Geno can do. What about you?
100% agree, mate. You kind of feel for him, but, you know, you can look at players like, you know, I don't know, you look at like, let's have a think, you know, maybe players like Devin Smith, you know, would start, and he, you know, if it, you know, there's players, as you said, in that second, that those backup roles who deserve that second string, you know, to have opportunities, you know, who are probably good enough to have opportunities.
Leonard Williams.
Exactly, that's a great
Leonard
point.
Williams.
Yeah, Leonard Williams.
You put him in almost any other team, he's their starting defensive end. Probably their number one defensive end. I really can't think of a team besides Houston and the Jets, possibly Buffalo, and possibly New England, who he wouldn't be their number one guy on. And, you know, Sheldon will probably be gone in a couple of years. Obviously, we got Mo signed up. But Leonard Williams is a guy who definitely needs to take the opportunity here if Sheldon's one-game suspension. I wouldn't be shocked if they continued to move Sheldon around a little bit, even at outside linebacker. I know we have better depth there this year, but why not if Leonard Williams is playing well? You move him around. Mm. And, Kyle, we haven't really heard your take. The other Kyle, obviously not referring to myself. Kyle, what was your take on the whole Todd Bowles statement there, saying he really did feel sorry for, you know, that a lot of players have second string who deserve to start?
I mean, why should Todd Bowles feel sorry for Geno Smith? These guys are getting paid millions of dollars to play a game that they love. And, you know, Geno Smith is probably going to cash in. I mean, listen, if he plays a competent backup, backups are getting, you know, $4 or $5 million contracts per year. So if Geno Smith goes out and proves, you know, like let's say he gets some limited action, if Fitz goes down for a couple plays, Geno shows something this season, you know, teams are going to look at that. They're going to get that film. Hey, listen, let's sign this guy up to be our backup. I mean, Chase Daniel got, what, $7 million a year to be a backup? So why should Todd Bowles feel bad for him? The fact of the matter is Geno Smith put himself in a spot where he didn't play too great in other circumstances, but he still wasn't good those first 2 years. And, you know, I mean, the reality is Fitz came in, he won those amount of games, and, you know, Geno didn't deserve to get his job back, so he shouldn't feel bad for him. I mean, it's different when you're a coach. You can't go and say, I feel bad for a player. We can say that as fans because, you know, we grow and love players and things like that, but it's almost like a sign of weakness if you're a coach saying, oh, I feel bad for the kid because he lost his starting job because, you know, someone else signed. I mean, I think it looks as a sign of weakness.
I do want to add in,
Kyle, you said something about why not move Sheldon Richardson to outside linebacker. I think it's going to be a tremendous mistake if the Jets do that. The reality is this guy is a great three technique. He's a great interior pass rusher. Now, he's super athletic. There's no doubt about that. He's got a great first step. You know, the great first step, that burst to get upfield and penetrate. But the reality is he doesn't have the type of hip flexibility and bend to get around the edge to sack a quarterback from an edge rusher spot. So if you're putting – I get it. Leonard Williams and Muhammad Wilkerson, there's only so many mouths to feed. But because Damon Harrison's gone now, why not kick one of those guys over to the interior? You know, because you got that void with him there now. I think it's a big mistake if he plays him at major reps at outside linebacker. Every now and then, if you want to confuse someone with a scheme, that's fine.
Yeah.
But to play major reps there is a huge mistake.
I'm not saying permanently keep him there. In fact, I mentioned it a couple weeks ago that we should probably move one of them to the defensive tackle because they all played it at college, and they all played it well, and they all transitioned to the defensive end in the pros because that's where they're more fit. The only problem or downside I can see with that is you got guys like Jarvis Jenkins and Steve McClendon who can fill that void perfectly. I mean, it's sad to say that we have too much depth at a position where, like you said, not everybody's mouth can be fed. And, you know, Todd Bowles also said today that, I believe I already said it, it's a good thing having too many good quarterbacks, and I'll put in a different context. It's kind of a bad thing right now to have too many good defensive linemen, and I think that's why Sheldon will be gone soon, especially when we went out and signed Steve McClendon and Jarvis Jenkins, and I'm sure guys like Claude Pallone might make this roster defensive tackle. So there are just too many mouths to feed, like you said, Kyle, and that's why I would like to experiment with Sheldon in sub-packages where he could rush the passer from a more distant place. They like to call it the outside linebacker, but it's really just a skinny defensive end who's faster. So, Sean, before we let you go, and once again, thank you for the fantastic call. I know this is very hard for you to do. You got to go through Google to call us because you're overseas. You got to wake up early and just thank you for calling. So give us your social media so we can properly give you the shout-out you deserve because you always drop knowledge on the show, man, and we really appreciate it when you call in.
Hey, thank you so much, guys. I appreciate the opportunity. So my Twitter is @WalshNYJets. I'm always on there. I'm up for a conversation. I write. Just started with Joe Caparoso at Turn on the Jets. So I'm really excited about that. Contributing once a week with the roundtables, and then we will have. I'm having a few articles we're going to filter out in the next couple of weeks. With the UK Jets, exciting news, I'll announce it on your show just for you guys. Exclusive here for you. UK Jets HQ releasing a website. I don't know whether you guys are familiar or have heard about that.
I've not heard about your website.
Yeah, so for the first time ever, we're going to have an Australian New York Jets website.
That's awesome.
And website.
And I will say this, that I think it's great that you're writing for Turn on the Jets because so many young writers that, you know, started off writing there, you know, they've gone up to get, you know, higher positions and stuff. So, yeah. I mean, they have great writers over there and great content, people that truly understand the game. So I think you're in a good spot.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I'm so excited to start there. One last quick one. A little bit of a sour note for us Australians this morning. Tommy Hackett getting cut. Congratulations to my boy Lachlan Edwards. Lucky enough to meet him just after the draft. Had a great half an hour Skype chat with him. He's a great kid. So he'll definitely this year expect him to, you know, I'm going to say he might average 45 net. He's just got a massive leg, and I'm really excited to see what he can do, you know.
Yeah,
absolutely. I didn't want to bring that up for you because I know you get really good into the punters, and we're kind of scarce on time for tonight. And I'm glad you did touch on it because I remember you met Lachlan Edwards at some point after the draft, and I remember you telling us and Ben that he was going to be a great player for us and he was going to revolutionize our special team.
Yeah. Hey, real quickly, guys. I know you have to go really quick. One last one. The outside linebacker position.
Okay.
Do you think that Deion Barnes will get a roster spot?
I actually do. I really do. I think the kid really impressed me last year in the preseason. I think he's going to get one.
Yeah,
I think
yeah,
you want to have.
Looking,
go ahead, Kyle.
I'm looking at my depth chart right now, and no, I have him on our practice squad, though. I have him as one of our top guys on our practice squad.
One of
my roster bubble guys was Mike Catapano, and if you look at him, what he did last year, he was playing in some games last year. You know, he was effective. He had a nice burst. You know, he was effective getting some QB pressures. But he's got a Liz Frank injury, and I don't know of a single NFL player that has come off a Liz Frank injury and had any type of NFL success after that. So you're talking about a roster bubble guy to begin with coming off that type of major injury. I like what I saw from him, but to me, I don't know that he's going to be recovered and have the same type of explosiveness. So for me, I gave Deion Barnes the nod over him.
Yeah,
well, it's
I'm,
funny because
gonna...
I have that exactly reversed. I have my Conopano over Deion Barnes. I was not aware that was a Dak's injury. I know that's a bad injury.
This is a San Antonio Holmes injury right there.
Yeah. Is that the one he fumbled on against
I'm have
the 49ers?
To,
yep. Exactly. It was so painful that he had to let go of the ball.
Yeah. I'm gonna have to go. That's an injury. You know, that's such a. We have it. It's quite common in rugby league over here.
Oh really?
Okay.
There's careers that have just ended on the spot. So that's something definitely something that we're gonna have to look out for to see. Because that's an injury that's so it's so hard to get right, you know. So it's gonna be hard. That's just one that I've had going around in my head for 24 hours. You know, just looking at I've got my own depth chart here. Just having a look at it. Thanks guys. Hey. I'll let you go. I'm wrapping on now.
Thanks, Sean. And maybe you could tweet us your depth chart. We appreciate it.
Hey, yeah. Not a worries, guys. I will do. Thanks, guys. Have a great day.
Take care, Sean.
Thanks for being on. All right, Kyle. It's weird saying like Kyle. I'm so used to saying Ben or him saying me. It's just so weird. I'm gonna have to get used to this. We're gonna go on to our next topic of the night, and this is something that I am very in favor of, and I've introduced on multiple shows, including yours. I believe I said it in a hurry last Tuesday night when I was on your show, and that is, do you think Quincy Enunwa could be our tight end over Jason Morrow?
Yeah, but I think that both of them will play significant reps. And I think the fact of the matter is Kellen Davis was brought in here to be a blocking tight end. But I'm not so sure he is that. And I do think that he'll make the initial 50. I think he'll make the initial 53. But don't be surprised if this guy is a mid-season cut or even early season cut for that matter. The fact of the matter is he's just not very good. And I think that if you start to see Jay Samaro take strides, because we really haven't seen much of that with the Jets, then they'll think, you know, why do we even need this guy? Anunwa is a pretty good blocker for what we do. And if we really want to just bring in an extra big body to block on the line, we can just bring an extra offensive lineman in. So I definitely think that Davis could definitely get cut at some point in the year. But, yeah, I mean, Anunwa, he's interesting. And, like, you know, sometimes when you look at Madden, you know, like a lot of people were out there saying, oh, how did Muhammad Wilkerson not even get in the top five DNs? Well, maybe he's getting listed as a defensive tackle. And I said, you know, that could be possible because he does play reps on the interior. But here's the thing. In the NFL, like, you know, sometimes it's very archaic. If you label someone as just a tight end or you label someone as, you know, just a certain position, the fact of the matter is Quincy Enunwa moved a lot last year. He played a lot of H-back, more H-back more so than a tight end. And he also played, you know, some reps on the outside as a receiver, and some reps on the inside as a receiver. So this guy, he's going to move around a lot, but he's a very, very effective blocker. You know, you can go and search GIF images of him taking out guys like Olivier Vernon, who just got the Muhammad Wilkerson contract, basically, you know, taking out guys like that. I mean, there's no doubt about it. The Jets, the statistics don't lie. When he was out, the Jets were, you know, probably averaging about 30 yards less rushing yards per game than when he was in there. So he's definitely a good blocker, and that's what you want in a tight end. A traditional tight end is a guy that can catch passes and block. And there's no doubt that he can catch passes, too. He was a wide receiver. So I think you'll see both him and Amaro play major reps, and you'll even see them on the field together. Don't doubt that for 1 second, because I think that Amaro and Onunwa, both of them, can be better receiving options than guys like Kenbrell Tompkins or even guys like Devin Smith when you factor in his ACL tear and the fact that, you know, who knows where he's going to be and, you know, can he refine some of his other routes that he runs? Because he's been known for the deep ball, but we all know Fitz isn't good at throwing that. Guys like Jalen Marshall, Sherrone Peak, I'm not expecting much out of them. What's up, Kyle?
I wouldn't necessarily say that about Ryan Fitzpatrick. He isn't a quarterback that's going to be able to chuck it 60 yards downfield whenever he wants. I have seen him throw some pretty nice balls that are at least 45 to 50. We saw it in the Dolphins game. I believe it was the first play of the game to Brandon Marshall. I counted that as a 47-yard pass, and that was on the dime, in my opinion. Then you look at the Buffalo game, the last game of the year. He threw a dime right to Kenbrell Tompkins in the pocket towards the sideline. I caught it. It's 53 yards. It was a beautiful throw. He did it when he needed to. You know, unfortunately, Kenbrell Tompkins couldn't hold on to it because, you know, he did kind of lead him into a safety, but he was taking a risk that was needed to take, and he made a perfect throw. He just didn't hang on to it. So I think Fitzpatrick, I give him like 55 yards, and he has to really wind up. And that should be enough for most big play wide receivers like Jalen Marshall and Devin Smith. I know they like to go 60 yards, but they can slow down a little sometimes. And I think it will still be effective. We just got to incorporate it. I don't know if it was necessarily because he doesn't like to do it, but Chan Gailey, I've never really seen it in his offense. Never really saw it in Buffalo with Ryan Fitzpatrick when his arm was stronger and he was younger. I'm sure as the years gone on, his arm strength has deteriorated, so I'm assuming he could have thrown at least 60 yards when he was younger in Buffalo, and that's plenty for deep balls. I mean, that's Hail Mary yardage. So I wouldn't necessarily say that Ryan Fitzpatrick can't throw the deep ball. He can when he wants to. He's just more of a dink and dog, cross up the middle, 20-yard pass type of guy.
Kyle, you are so wrong about this. So wrong.
Man.
And you know, me and you have been in agreement for a lot of this show. But, I mean, listen, the numbers don't lie. He's one of the worst deep-throwing quarterbacks in the league.
He doesn't like
it. It's not about liking. It's not about liking, Kyle.
He isn't always good at it.
Kyle, I've sent you stats before. I'll send you more stats. He's one of the worst deep-throwing quarterbacks. And listen, regardless of stats, what do your eyes tell you when you watch? This is a guy that you cherry-picked and picked two examples. Well, let's go to the Miami game. Ryan Fitzpatrick had to put every little last ounce of his body to make that throw.
Yep.
And you know what happened? Brandon Marshall had to stop running to be able to catch that ball. It's not like he caught it in stride. He just out-muscled the small Brent Grimes, who's like 5'9 as a corner, versus Brandon Marshall, who's 6'4, 230. And Brandon Marshall had to slow down, go back, go up, and catch that ball. He didn't catch it in stride. And you want to talk about this Kenbrell Tompkins example. I mean, that ball could have very well been picked off by the safety. In fact, the defender was actually out of position at first. It wasn't, and it certainly wasn't caught either. And it's not like Tompkins was hit in stride either. So he's not a great deep ball thrower, not even close. He's one of the worst in the league.
I'm not saying he's great. I'm not saying he's great. I'm saying he has the ability when he needs to. So I'm like sick of people saying he can't do it at all. You don't need to go deep every single play. If Devin Smith can only run deep routes, that's his problem, right? Conform to this offense. You are not.
I agree with you there.
Chan Gailey asked you to run to the middle. I mean, and guys like Jalen Marshall, I doubt will even be in the passing game a lot. I consider him more of a punt returner / kick returner. Do I think he'll have a role? Yes, but not a very big one. So let's conform to what we have. I mean, nothing's ever going to be perfect in the NFL. Look at Carson Palmer. There are tons of things that he can't do that his offense has to conform to. Honestly, I don't think he has a lot of strength on his ball. A lot of times he just kind of lollipops it in, at least from what I've seen. And Larry Fitzgerald has very good hands, and I think a lot of those balls that he throws are very droppable and very hard to catch, but he has some good receivers bailing him out, and I just say the same thing about Ryan Fitzpatrick. So every quarterback has their weakness. Ryan Fitzpatrick just doesn't have the strongest arm, but he can do it when he has to. Not saying he's great. I'm not even saying he's good. I'm saying he can do it when he has to. And from what I've seen in certain plays, they were pretty decent.
Well, there's no doubt that any quarterback, like, there's no doubt that he had some successful throws. He is an NFL quarterback. But can he do it with consistency? Because consistency is the name of the game when you're playing NFL quarterback. You could have, you know, 30 great passes in a game, but if you throw one disastrous interception into coverage that gets taken back for a pick six, that's a game changer.
Yep.
Consistency is the name of the game, and Ryan Fitzpatrick, even though in certain instances he can get a ball down there, he cannot do it with consistency. I'll leave it at that. If you want, I'll go out and throw you some statistics on Twitter later in the evening. But, yeah, that's that. But I'm totally in agreement with you. It is a problem if Devin Smith can only run the 9 route. If he can only run go routes, well, I mean, you're not worth the 37th overall pick in the draft. You have to do other things if you want to be a successful NFL receiver. I'm sorry. You know, Mike Wallace always whines and complains because, oh, you know, my quarterback can't get me the deep ball. Well, Mike Wallace, you can't do anything else. You don't fight for balls and stuff. So, yeah, Devin Smith definitely needs to get there. But I want to ask you a question, and I don't know if this is going into the depth chart and all that kind of stuff, and if you want to wait, but it seems like you're a Jalen Marshall guy, and it seems like you think he's going to make this 53-man roster. Please do explain yourself.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think he's going to make the roster. I don't have the full team right now in front of me. I'm looking at my 53-man depth chart. His main role for me, I have him as our fifth receiver on the depth chart, and I'm counting Quincy Enunwa as a tight end because I cut Kellen Davis, and I'm just having Quincy Enunwa as our backup tight end, but he'll probably play more of a wide receiver role because, like you said, he's a better blocker than Kellen Davis and a better pass catcher than Kellen Davis. I have so many things against Kellen Davis, it's not even funny. So I think we saved space there. Oops, sorry about that. That's my dog. Jalen Marshall will be more of a punt returner slash kick returner type of guy. I have him beating out Jeremy Ross in this competition, and I believe there's one other guy that I may be forgetting for this competition. Remind me if I am, Kyle. It's not Jerome Peake, but is there anybody else who's competing for the punt returner, kick returner?
Let's see. Jeremy Ross, you mentioned Jalen Marshall. Not that I can think of. Those seem to be the top two guys. I mean, the Jets have put Eric Decker back at punt return every now and then, but I don't think that's a smart move.
Yeah, so I think Jalen Marshall will make his name there in training camp as the kick returner slash punt returner. That's how I have him making this team. So, yeah, I'm a decent fan of Jalen Marshall. I had him ranked ahead of Braxton Miller in this year's draft class, and you might say that, oh, Kyle, you're biased because now he's a Jet. You can go look it up, LockerTalkSports.com, Ohio State rankings, the player rankings from Ohio State. I already said the website. So, yes, I'm a Jalen Marshall guy.
You know, I don't get the obsession with him. And one of the people that I respect a lot is Rich Tinley, the co-host of No Fly Zone Radio, good friends with Biff Sweeney, the other co-host of No Fly Zone Radio. Rich said that he thinks Jalen Marshall is a more talented player than Devin Smith. I just don't get it. I look at Jalen Marshall, and I see Jeremy Curley. I see a guy who's not overly fast. He's not explosive. In my eyes, doesn't even have sure hands. I don't see him as a crafty route runner. I mean, I see Jeremy Curley that's less athletic in my book. If you want to talk about Curley when he came out of college, Curley was the more polished, productive player in college. So if Jalen Marshall is going to make this team, it's not going to be for his receiving abilities. Maybe, just maybe, it can be for his punt return abilities. But I think that would be because Jeremy Ross doesn't impress at all, and they just want to go with the younger guy. But I don't expect too much out of either of these guys returning.
Well, I think Jalen Marshall is a step up from what we had last year, like you said, Eric Decker. But at the same time, I disagree with you being Jalen Marshall not being explosive. He was recruited to Ohio State originally to be a quarterback. I mean, you go and look up Jalen Marshall on Google, it says he could be the next great quarterback to come out of Ohio State. So the guy has talent, all right? He was explosive. He was considered one of those dual-threat Wildcat quarterbacks in high school, which seems to bring a lot of guys success at that level. So he is pretty fast. I don't know exactly what he ran at the combine, but if he ran a 4.5 or under, I consider that fast. Say what you want. That's fast. All right?
It's a 4.6, Kyle.
They're okay. 4.6,
really slow for a 200-pound guy. 5'10", 200 pounds, running a 4.6, slow.
All right, so that's slower than I expected him to be. But I know for a fact he is athletic, and he can be explosive. Because I've seen it firsthand at Ohio State. You can look up his highlights. I mean, he was a playmaker for them. He was a big part of their championship run. And there were other guys in front of him, like Devin Smith, like Braxton Miller last year. I'm trying to remember the other wide receiver's name. He got drafted this year. Mike something.
Michael Thomas.
Got it. Michael Thomas, yeah. He was in front of him as well. So he was kind of buried on the depth chart, but he made his name in the punt returning game. He was a good wide receiver when he needed him to be, and I saw him run a lot of dual threat quarterback options when they wanted to take JT Thomas or Cordell Jones out for certain reasons. Urban Meyer likes to do that. But I've seen him do it, and I think he can do it for the Jets.
I mean, you brought up the fact that he was a quarterback in high school. I mean, that doesn't necessarily translate to you being athletic or explosive. In fact, I mean, if you want to look at measurables, quarterbacks typically don't have great 40 times, don't have great three-cone times, don't have great broad jumps and all that type of stuff. And I'm looking at Marshall.
He was one of those dual-threat quarterbacks. It wasn't like a drop-back and throw a deep type of quarterback. He was the type of quarterback that has the Fitzpatrick type of mindset, where you dink and duck to the nearest open receiver, and if you can't find the receiver, you run. Fitzpatrick doesn't do that part, but he does the first part.
Okay, so maybe if you kept him on the roster, you could maybe run a type of fake pass, like, for example, what the Patriots did in the playoff game against the Ravens, where they threw a screen pass to Julian Edelman, and then he threw it deep. You could maybe use him on some type of trickery or like that, but just to say because he's a quarterback that all of a sudden he's explosive is just far from the truth. And I don't see it with the guy. And you said, listen, he created plays at Ohio State. I disagree. That team was absolutely stacked, offense and defense. And you had guys like Michael Thomas, who was a second-round pick, and you had guys like Ezekiel Elliott. Those guys were creating. Those guys were getting the defense's attention. Those guys were getting, for example, Thomas, double coverage, whereas Marshall was just simply capitalizing off the fact that he was getting the single coverage. So I'm in total disagreement with anybody that is on the Jalen Marshall bandwagon.
See, I don't like it when people say that. They just say, oh, they really capitalized off of the system or they capitalized off of other good players. No, is that their fault that they're making plays because other people are double covered? And he's going to be in the exact same situation here with the Jets. A lot of teams that will call for Brandon Marshall or Eric Decker. Then you got to look out for Matt Forte. Then you got to look out for Bilal Powell. Account in Jason Morrow now. Account in Quincy Enunwa. Heck, I've even seen Ryan Fitzpatrick run for first downs. So somebody's got to get open eventually. And I think Jalen Marshall can be that guy from time to time. I think he's decently fast regardless of that thing. He's slower than I want him to be. I wasn't aware that it was a 4.6. That's a little slower than I want. But still, I've seen him be athletic. I've seen him be explosive. He could be good in the punt return game. He could be a huge upgrade on special teams for us from what we had last year. So that's why I'm keeping him on this roster. I think he's a young talent that can definitely do a lot of good for us.
Okay, fair enough. Do you want to go into your entire 53-man prediction at this point now?
No, we have...
You there? Kyle, you there still? Kyle, are you there?
Yeah, I don't know what happened. It just logged me out. Sorry about that, guys. We'll just go on to our next caller real quick, and this is Jaden. Jaden, thanks for calling into the Jet Pick, man. What's going on?
Nothing much. Just here to talk about some Jets.
How's it going, Jaden?
Going good.
So, what would you like to talk about?
Anything. I mean, this Fitzpatrick deal just got done.
Yeah, and your thoughts?
I assume you guys have been talking about.
Yeah, we gave our thoughts on Fitzpatrick and what he's going to do or what he's not going to do for this team, but why don't you tell us your thoughts?
I don't think he's going to do what he did last year because of the schedule, but I definitely hope he takes us to the playoffs, and that's definitely plausible, but we're just going to have to see how the special teams, I think, is going to be our X factor.
Yeah, I mean, it would be hard to believe that the special teams can't be better than what it was last year, because it was just absolutely putrid last year.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we were just talking about Jalen Marshall, and that's a guy who I think can definitely improve the special teams. You know, regardless of what other people will say, he does show explosiveness. He can be a good kick returner. He had the best 20-yard shuttle in the whole combine. He had a 4.13. He was the best there. Isn't the fastest guy when it comes to 40, but really at the end of the day, the 40s are just seeing what type of speed you have without the pads on. I want to see the guys that have the speed with the pads on. I think he's one of those type of guys. Other parts of the special teams that I think have definitely improved, Deron Lee and Jordan Jenkins getting drafted. They will be playing special teams roles. Quincy Enunwa. I don't know if we'll throw Jason Morrow in there, but we should because he's a big body and, you know, he's got decent speed for the big guy that he is. I'm sure he can lay the hit down when he needs to. You look at the kicker position. Either way, between Ross Martin or Nick Folk, whoever will be the starting kicker day one, it's improved from Randy Bullock. I mean, Randy Bullock did his job and he did it pretty
fat
well.
Fat Randy.
But at the end of the day, I'm taking Fat Randy. That is something. We are so mean to him. He did a decent job for us. At the end of the day, Nick Folk or Ross Martin will be better. And you look at the punter position. We had Ryan Quigley, a guy who couldn't even make the Eagles roster. The Eagles, ladies and gentlemen. He was our starting punter last year. He had a great year before that, and he turned terrible. Don't know what happened. But now we got Lachlan Edwards, who, in my opinion, was the second best punter in the draft. We just waived the first punter in the draft, at least on my boards. I had Tom Hackett being a better punter than him. Obviously, that isn't true today, but or at least in the eyes of Todd Bowles and Mike Maccagnan. I think the punter position has improved either way, whoever it will be. So I think the special team has definitely improved.
You know, here's an interesting question about special teams. Is if you look at 2014 college football, who was one of the best gunners, punt team gunners on special teams? It was Devin Smith. He was awesome
absolutely.
At being a gunner. When did he tear his ACL last year? It was against the Titans, and he was the gunner on a punt. So maybe, just maybe, the Jets are going to look at, all right, listen, this kid was a heavy investment for us, 37th overall, tore his ACL on special teams. Do we really want to expose him to injury again on special teams? So maybe they don't put him out there, even though he's good. Listen, it's just food for thought.
You can't play football like that. You can't play football like that. If you can't remain healthy playing what you're good at, because he's not being a good receiver for us because he only wants to run these little straight routes like you said. Well, I believe you called it the 9 route. I've never heard it called that way. I call it the shifty.
It's a route tree, man. Look it up.
I call it the shifty because he kind of does that little move at the beginning. He shifts the corner off a little bit, then he blows past him. That's what I call it. I have my own little playbook. But we're getting off topic. You can't play scared. And I love saying this because it's true. The Jets have the best doctors in the NFL. We have the best team staff. There's a reason a lot of those guys were healthy last year. I mean, you look at guys like Brandon Marshall, they had some pretty bad injuries. I know for a fact he messed up his knee. Yeah, he got the necessary treatment immediately, and I believe he was back on the field the next week starting. I don't know if it was that great of a performance, but at least he was on the field. You know, sometimes you don't have to have a great performance. If you're just on the field taking up a body, that's a good day, especially if your team wins. So I'm very confident in this these doctors that we have, the medical staff. That's why I'm not too worried about Ryan Clady getting injured. And I'm never worried about a player getting injured. Because if you're going to live your life like that, and if you're going to be on my team making millions of dollars like that, get off of it, or I'll just fire you or cut you.
Well, the reality is, Kyle, is that good teams, once players, you know, take prominent roles on their team, they don't play them on special teams anymore. You know, guys like Julian Edelman, who was a seventh-round pick.
Kevin Smith is in a prominent role.
Okay, but Kyle, the Jets drafted him with the intention that he will be. You don't take a guy 37th overall if you don't think he's going to be that guy. So let's say that Devin Smith comes out, and even if Fitzpatrick's not hooking up with him because he can't hit the deep ball, if Devin Smith is making constant separation, which teams' defenses have to account for, you have to wonder in your mind if the Jets are going to say, listen, this kid is effective on offense, regardless of whether or not he's catching the ball. Why are we playing him on special teams when that's when he tore his ACL last year? Why expose him to injury? I'm just saying. Food for thought.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, Jaden, any other topics you would like to discuss besides the special teams?
I know I asked you this on your Periscope, but other Kyle, what do you think about our expectations for the Jets defense?
I think the Jets defense is going to be very good. That's not my question with this team. I more so question the offense. You know, I think that the Jets needed to do what they did on defense and getting young, fast linebackers, getting some more speed on the team. The defensive line was already stacked. I would have like them to address more in the secondary, but they did draft Justin Burris in the fourth round. You can never have too many corners.
Yep.
I think the defense is going to be great. More of my questions come with the offense, particularly with the offensive line and quarterback play. And in my mind, you just look at the amount of teams that make the playoffs every single year. It's extremely rare that a team makes the playoffs when they have subpar, below average quarterback play. And that's exactly what the Jets have. Subpar, below average quarterback play.
Well,
but we had such a dynamic offense.
I would say he had an above average season last year. He had a decent season, Kyle.
Kyle, did you see the retweet that I retweeted yesterday from your boy that shares the same last name as you, Sion Efehi, where he said, y'all be looking at Fitzpatrick like this, where he took Ryan Fitzpatrick's stats and he started blotting out all the bad parts of his stats. People like to look at the 31 touchdowns franchise record. Yes, he threw 31 touchdowns, but let's not forget, shout out to my boy Edward Gorelick, who did Ryan Fitzpatrick's stats in context, and Sion Fahey backed the same thing up in his QB catalog. Ryan Fitzpatrick threw at least 30 interceptable passes last year. Not passes that were intercepted, but had the defender caught the ball or had the, you know, had the offensive player, for example, Brandon Marshall, not made an amazing adjustment on the ball, it could have very well been intercepted. He threw at least 30 last year. Don't tell me that Ryan Fitzpatrick had an above-average season, because he didn't.
Okay, Kyle, this is how I respond to that. I eat a lot of cookie dough, right, when I'm making cookies. That's very dangerous. I could get sick, but I don't. So I'm going to continue to do it. And it's probably going to continue to be good for me because it's delicious and I'm not going to get sick. So that's the way I'm going to do it. Until he throws a season with like 20 interceptions, he keeps doing his thing. And that's the wide receiver's job. I don't care if they're making great adjustments. That's their job. That's what they're getting paid the millions and millions and millions of dollars for. So.
Okay, and what if Brandon Marshall goes down with an injury? You know, it's not crazy to think. You know, he was hurt his last season out in Chicago. What if he goes down and then Ryan Fitzpatrick is relying on lesser guys? You know, Quincy Enunwa gets thrusted into a bigger role and he has to fill Brandon Marshall's shoes. He cannot do what Brandon Marshall does. And you best believe that some of those 50-50 jump balls would start to go the defender's way. So, I mean, you got to think about it like that. But Jaden, going back to your main question again, the defense is going to be fine. Probably top two defensive line in the league. David Harris, very solid at linebacker. Darren Lee, you know, Jordan Jenkins seems to be an excellent young pick. Lorenzo Malden, we're all expecting a big jump from him. And no doubt the secondary is good. Pryor, Gilchrist, good safeties, not great. Revis, still a very good corner. And Screen, decent nickelback. I'll leave it at that. And you have some big question marks with who's going to be starting opposite Revis. But the defense will be very good, no doubt about it. And is Mr. Fahey still here?
Yeah, I'm here. I was just waiting to
see if
he had a response to that.
You go ahead, Jaden. All right. Well, I don't really see too much. If at all, I don't see any decline. Maybe we will be better this year on defense with those draft picks. And I'm skeptical about that offensive line. Obviously off topic, but that offensive line is very shaky, for lack of a better term.
Man, you're complimenting the offensive line there. I've never used somebody say shaky.
You think that's complimenting?
It's a little more than shaky.
Well, they're obviously
injury
prone and old. And
yeah.
What's your opinion?
Basically, my opinion is I think if we can keep Ryan Clady healthy, which I think we will, I think he'll go back to what he was, which was a Pro Bowl tackle in this league. I mean, say what you want about the weapons in Denver. He was a big part of why Peyton Manning went there. Peyton Manning knew that he had somebody good protecting his blind side.
On his blind
side. He was very cautious of that coming off of that surgery, and who wouldn't be? You know, I just yelled at Kyle for saying, you know, you can't play football like that, but this is a quarterback. He has to play it. There's no other place you can really push him. So, then you look at James Carpenter. He did a phenomenal job for us last year. I think he was a Pro Bowl snub. Nick Mangold is Nick Mangold, future Hall of Famer. He will continue to be good for us until the day he retires, barring injury. Brian Winters has improved. Still below average right guard in this league, in my opinion. Then you go over to Brino, the bad Giacomini. He needs to be cut immediately in favor of Anthony Davis. Maybe even Brent Quolvay and save us $5 million. So, the left side of the line, we're all good. I think three of them are Pro Bowlers. They're Pro Bowl talent, at least. I don't know if they'll make it, but they got Pro Bowl talent when healthy and when producing well. The right side, excluding Nick Mangold, is shaky. Regarding Brian Winters, add in Brino Giacomini. It's terrible. Terrible on the right side.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more.
All right, Jaden, we appreciate the call, man.
Thank you.
Yeah, before we let you go, give us your social media platforms or Twitter specifically.
Yeah, go ahead and follow me on Twitter at DeAngeloJaden, no underscore, no dot, no period.
All right, man,
appreciate
the call.
Oh, yeah, you're my Snapchat buddy. Yeah, thanks for being on.
What? Yep.
You're my Snapchat buddy. You followed me on Snapchat the other day.
Oh, yeah, I
added that, yeah. All right, well, thanks for being on.
Yep.
All right, so that was a great call from Jaden there. We'll be sure to shout him out. And now's the time I've been personally waiting for. And Kyle, we alluded to this multiple times throughout the show. We're going to go over our depth charts right now, and we're going to tell each other what we honestly think of them, who we think will make the team, who we think has it wrong, who we think has it right. So, Kyle, I don't know if you have yours set up, but if you don't, I'll just give you a minute to set it up, and I'll start with the wide receiver position, because that's how I have it set up on my depth chart.
Go ahead.
I have him in the wide receiver slot because I know I sent it to you, but I consider Quincy Nunn one of my backup tight ends. So I have Brandon Marshall, Eric Decker, Kembrell Tompkins, Jalen Marshall, and Sherrone Peake at the wide receiver position. Jalen Marshall will be my punt returner slash kick returner. So So in reality, it's just Brandon Marshall, Decker, Kimbrel Thompson, and Jerome Peake as my main guys.
Yeah, and I have the same thing there, except for I flip-flop and put Jeremy Ross there instead of Jalen Marshall. And I think that, you know, Jeremy Ross has stuck around in the league before. He's made rosters solely based on his return abilities. Jalen Marshall is an undrafted guy, hasn't done that yet. And I think that Jeremy Ross is the more athletic guy. He's got more top-end speed. And I think that's something that teams really seek after when they want a returner. So I got Ross instead of Jalen Marshall. But other than that, we got the same.
Okay, so I don't know what your depth chart looks like, but my next position is left tackle. Is that what yours looks like?
Not exactly, but I got my offensive line in front of me. Go ahead with yours, though.
All right. At left tackle specifically, and I'll go over right tackle in a second, even though it's not pretty, I got Ryan Clady and Ben Ajalana.
Okay, no disagreement there.
And then at right tackle, I have Bruno Giacomini, unfortunately, and Brandon Schell, who can also double as a guard.
Okay. We're in agreement. Let's talk about the interior line now.
Yep. At right guard, I have Brian Winters and Jarvis Harrison.
Okay.
At center, I have Nick Mangold and Wesley Johnson. Unfortunately, I don't have Kyle Friend on there. Even though I would love to have a fellow Kyle on the Jets, it's just that I think Wesley Johnson's a little bit better, and he knows the offense, and he's played with Brian Fitzpatrick before. And then at left guard, I have James Carpenter and Brent Qualbeck.
Yeah, and we have all the same offensive linemen, no disagreement there. I will say this.
Yeah.
Don't be shocked if Jarvis Harrison pushes Brian Winters for a starting job. Now, Winters actually, you know, he surprised last year. He played a little bit better than I think some Jets fans were expecting. I mean, this kid was a third-round draft pick. We had high expectations for him, but he was straight-up horrible his first couple years. But Jarvis Harrison, he's always had that athletic talent. Go and look at the measurables. Go and look at his Texas A&M tape. The dude flashed at certain points in time, but he's kind of one of those guys you always wonder, does he truly love football? Because he would take plays off a la Quentin Copels. He's got that a little bit of that in him. But when he was turned on in training camp last year, he was owning guys in one-on-ones. So he's got potential. If some kind of fire was lit under his butt, he can be a better player than a Brian Winters. So just putting that out there, but we'll see what happens. I would still give the nod to Winters to start. But I wouldn't be shocked at all if Jarvis Harrison could unseat him.
Yeah, I'm looking at his draft profile right now on NFL.com. His NFL comparison is Kalish Yasemele, who just cashed in big time with the Oakland Raiders. He's one of the top guards in the league. And this is what the scout says. He has Pro Bowl caliber talent, but his work ethic is a major concern. That's basically what you just said. So I'll take your word for it there. I obviously don't have the pleasure of going to these practices, seeing as I'm down in Florida. I don't know exactly where you are in New York. I'm assuming you're in New York. But also, fair warning, some of these guys could be switched around on the offensive line. Like, I know Brent Qualbe can also double as a tackle. Brandon Schell can also double as a guard. So that's not exactly what your depth chart is like for the people at home. You know, don't be upset. So let's go to the tight end. I already said one of them. Basically, we know the two. I got Jason Morrow as our one. And Quincy Nunwa as our two. Personally, I think Quincy Nunwa is better, but he can double as a wide receiver. So I have him as our two because I think he'll be playing double roles.
Okay, fair enough. And, yes, I have both those guys listed there as well. I don't think that you got Kellen Davis down as of right now to make the Jets' initial 53 for week one. I do have him, but I'll go back to what I said earlier. I wouldn't be shocked at all if he's cut sometime during the regular season.
Yeah, I think he's just a player that's not worth it. You know what you're going to get for him. He's signed as a blocking tight end. He can't do that. So I don't think he deserves a roster spot.
I'm with you on that. But I think that the Jets I'm with you on that, but I think that the Jets are going to look at it and say, well, we haven't seen anything from Amaro in the last, you know, year, so we don't know where he's going to be. And Quincy Enunwa is still not a true tight end. So maybe they're going to want to see a little bit more of him in that role before. So I just think that they're going to carry a more traditional blocking guy until a certain point in the season. But anyway, let's move on.
Yeah, in quarterback position right now, me and Ben did this together. This isn't exactly the team I might actually put together myself. It's mostly correct for my point of view. Quarterback is the one position where I think Ben was wrong, but for argument's sake, I just went with him. We have Ryan Fitzpatrick at one, which is good because I didn't want to change that. I'm happy he signed before we did this. We got Geno Smith at two. Then we got Christian Hackenberg at three. And we have Bryce Petty on the practice squad. Ben thinks he'll clear waivers. I don't think he will. But I think he would be gone. And that's why I don't want to cut him. I'd rather keep him on the roster and keep him for when Geno's going next year as our number two. Because I think Fitzpatrick will be back next year again. We'll have to give him another bullcrap contract. But that's just fair warning there. I'd rather have Bryce Petty than a guy like Daryl Morris in the secondary or Mike Conopano, who I also have on this team. So what's your quarterback depth chart looking like?
Yeah, totally in agreement. Ryan Fitzpatrick 1, Geno Smith 2, Christian Hackenberg 3. There's no doubt that the Jets don't want to play Christian Hackenberg at all this year. Jets.
Yep. Kyle, are you still there?
That's just silly. Now, in terms of Bryce Petty, yes, Kyle, can you hear me?
Repeat what you were saying because you cut out for a second. At least I couldn't hear you. I don't know if the listener's good, but you cut out for a second.
My apologies. Okay.
Yeah.
So Geno Smith is definitely the number two, and there are some people out there that think that he will get cut. In my eyes, that's just plain stupid. You don't want to play Christian Hackenberg. The Jets have said that the plan is to sit him this year. So you don't want to see him take the field under any circumstances. And the reality is that Bryce Petty, he was a 2 to 3 year project anyway, so he's not ready to start. You cannot put yourself in a situation where Ryan Fitzpatrick goes down and you're playing one of those two guys. And let's be honest, Ryan Fitzpatrick, he's not one of those quarterbacks like a Brady and Eli Manning where they basically missed no time. You know, he broke his leg, hurt his thumb last year. He missed significant amount of games when he was in Buffalo. And this guy's been hurt throughout his career. Not major injuries, I mean, not least with consistency, but he's missed a fair amount of games. And you don't want to have one of those guys as your backup. So Geno would definitely make this roster, in my opinion. Bryce Petty clearing waivers, I think that I'm with you. I don't think that he would clear waivers. I mean, he was a fourth-round draft pick for a reason. I think that, I mean, listen, you're looking at guys, he's got potential. He's got some type of potential. There's no doubt about that. Guys like Logan Thomas, who was raw just like Bryce Petty.
Arizona.
And he's moved around a lot. You know, Miami claimed him on waivers, and then I think the Giants claimed him on waivers. So young guys, teams are willing to take chances on them. So I feel like he wouldn't clear, but I would certainly hope that he would.
Yeah, I mean, that was just a situation where we're hoping he clear waivers. Like I said, I would keep him on this depth chart just for the reason that when Geno's gone next year, you know, we got a guy to go to because I don't think he'll be available. We're going on
But let me get this straight. So you want to keep four quarterbacks?
Yeah. I'd rather have and develop Bryce Petty as a guy who I know knows the offense more than Christian Hackenberg, at least. I think he's a better option than Christian Hackenberg, but we're not going to cut Christian Hackenberg. I'd rather have Bryce Petty than a guy like Daryl Morris or Mike Conopano, especially finding out that Mike Conopano's got that series of an injury. I knew he had a bad injury. I didn't know if it was that bad. I was not aware of that. That's my bad. So I don't even know if I will keep him on this roster at this point. So I might just cut him and bring Bryce Petty back up.
But let me just say this about Hackenberg versus Petty, and then I'll move on from it, is I'm not so sure that Petty does know the system better. Yes, he's been in it, so he's going to know Changeli's specific terminology better. But in terms of NFL concepts, I don't know that he's more far advanced than Christian Hackenberg, because the reality is Christian Hackenberg, as a freshman in college, he did run pro-style concepts.
Pro-style.
He's making second and third reads. Bryce Petty is a one-read type of guy in college, and he's never you know, so I don't know that he's more far advanced than Hackenberg. So I'll just say that. So I think it would be foolish to stack four quarterbacks on the roster. Teams don't really do that at all, especially nowadays in the NFL.
Yeah, I just don't want to lose a guy like that, especially if we wasted a fourth-round pick on him. I could go through that draft and find somebody. I believe Tyler Lockett is a good example that we could have drafted instead and could have made this team a lot better, and I hate when we lose talent. But anyway, going on to the fullback.
Lockett was a second-round pick.
Lockett was a second-round pick?
Yeah, Tyler Lockett was a second-rounder by the Seahawks.
Tyler Lockett?
Yeah.
Who am I thinking of? The guy for Arizona, John Brown? That's
different draft. John Brown was a year earlier. But anyway, let's move on.
I know I'm thinking of somebody who was a returner that could have helped us out. But anyway, fullback position, which seems that no team has anymore. They usually just have a big running back. I have Tommy Bohannon. There's nobody that I know besides Julian Houseware that will even give him a run for his money. I wouldn't even consider a run for his money. I would just consider him, you know, the guy who he may sit next to at lunch sometimes. Do you have anybody else at the fullback position?
No, just him. And, you know, some teams don't even carry fullbacks nowadays. So
yeah.
If they cut Bohannon, which is, I would say, at least a decent possibility, I do have him making the 53 just because he's solid. There's no doubt that he's a solid player. He's got decent hands. You know, he can give you a goal line rush every now and then. Okay blocker. He's certainly a strong guy, works hard. I do think he'll make the 53, but if he is cut, I don't think it'll be in place of another fullback.
No. So, you know, what we didn't discuss with Sheldon Richardson, I said we can move him around. I've seen him play some pretty decent fullback in this league. I believe he's rushed for more touchdowns than Kyrie Robinson did last year. So, that's just something to think of. But we'll keep moving on. Running back position. Matt Forte, Bilal Powell, and Kyrie Robinson. That's what I have. And then on the practice squad, because I'll include the practice squad in this just to let you know who I want to keep. Romar Moore. I don't want to keep him on the roster, but I want to keep him on the practice squad because I like what he's got. He's got good talent. I just don't think he'll beat out Kyrie Robinson.
Okay. And by the way, I didn't put together a practice squad, so I can't run through that with you, but just go ahead and say your guys and I'll make comments.
Yeah, Matt Forte, Bilal Powell, and Kyrie Robinson at the running back position.
Totally in agreement there.
Okay. Defense, the left defensive end. I got Muhammad Wilkinson, Jarvis Jenkins, and for now, Mike Conopano, because I was not aware of that injury. He probably will be cut in favor of Bryce Petty, though.
Yeah. Another thing to think about with that injury, too, it's not like it came in September. It came, I think, in December, maybe against the Giants,
yeah,
if I'm not mistaken. It was a December injury, so even more less time to recover. But, yeah, the D-line, there's probably no disagreement there. All these guys have decent contracts. Wilkerson, you know, we all know the deal he just signed. Leonard Williams, 6th overall pick. Sheldon Richardson, you know, 13th overall pick. Steve McClendon, they gave him a nice hefty contract. And Jarvis Jenkins, nice hefty contract as well. Deion Simon, I guess, maybe he's not a lock, but he's the only true...
I have him on there.
Yeah, now I would say he's the only true nose tackle. I get that McClendon will be playing some reps there, but McClendon is not—he's not super big like Snacks was. Snacks is pushing 350 pounds. Steve McClendon is about 25 pounds lighter, so not the same type of player that's just going to clog the middle and constantly occupy double teams.
Yeah, I just have him there because I think he's better than Deion Simon. A guy who I have on the practice squad is Claude Ballon. I like that free agent signing. Like, best friends with Leonard Williams. They have a lot of experience there. They have a lot of techniques. I went back and watched the film. They would do these certain stunts with each other where they would switch up last second on the line and just confuse the heck out of really good offensive lines at USC in practice, then in UCLA in certain games, and then Stanford, who had Andres Pete, Joshua Garnett this year. Just a lot of guys who were NFL talent players who they were dominating. So I kept Claude Pallone on the roster for that reason. I'll just do linebackers in general because you could switch them around whatever side you want. Lorenzo Molden, Aaron Henderson, David Harris, Trevor Riley, Jordan Jenkins, Bruce Carter, Deron Lee, and Freddie Bishop. And then on the practice squad, I have Tywan Jones and Deion Barnes.
Yeah, we have some disagreement here. I don't have I don't have Trevor Riley. No Trevor Riley for me. I just don't see it with him. I mean, this guy, he plays more of a pass rusher, but he's not explosive. You know, like I said, Catapano, you could see him getting upfield, getting off the ball quick. I don't see that with Riley. And Riley, let's not forget, he's an older player. He's like 27, 28 years
yeah.
old now.
Yep.
So
he was on a mission when he came out of the draft.
Yeah, so, I mean, the reality is the way that the NFL moves, it's a youth movement. So I think that they're going to look at it like, okay, well, what does this guy really bring to us? Yeah, he's solid. Maybe he can contribute on special teams and things like this. But do we really want to give him any type of decent reps as a linebacker? I don't think so. So the linebackers that I have is David Harris, Aaron Henderson, Darren
yep.
Lee, Bruce Carter, Jordan Jenkins, Lorenzo Malden, Deion Barnes. Like I said, the guy really impressed me last year, and I think that he's going to make a push this
uh-huh.
year. And I also have Tywan Jones.
Okay, so we have Freddie Bishop and Trevor Riley. I have them on the team, and I have Tywan Jones and Deion Barnes on the practice squad because I still think they're young talents who won't be able to make this team compared to these guys. Trevor Riley, I think, might get cut during the year because I think Jordan Jenkins can outplay him. I don't necessarily disagree with you there. I think he has a lot of good things on special teams, which is rare. He was one of the only decent special teams players for us last year, and I would like to reward him for that. He's done good things. He's a solid player, and I don't like cutting solid players who bring decent pass rush and special teams play, so that's why I'm keeping him, at least for now. Freddie Bishop is a guy who I see a lot of talent in. They're like, oh, he played in the CFL. Yeah, the CFL is much harder to pass rush in. They have to stand, I believe, 3 yards back from the offensive lineman or something like that. So those offensive linemen are getting huge advantages instead of here in the NFL where they're going face-to-face with guys like Lorenzo Molden or whichever way they line up. It's just harder in the CFL than it is in the NFL. So I think Freddie Bishop, who had like 12 sacks last year, I know it isn't the same talent, but it's a harder level of play when the way they set up. So that's why I'm keeping him on. I think you'll see a high motor out of him, a guy who's motivated to make an NFL roster. I mean, it's rare you see guys out of the CFL come and really make anything in the NFL. I think he's one of those guys that you can see be productive on a team from the CFL. I just love his motor. I love his talent. So I want to keep him on the team. Now, training camp will tell the tale of all these players. I mean, they aren't necessarily going to make the team. These are just my predictions. I could be absolutely wrong. He could be a lazy bum who just wants to go back to Canada and get his milk in a bag. So.
Yeah, the only pass rusher that I know from the CFL that has any NFL production is Cameron Wake. Now, Cameron Wake is a physical freak. Go and look at his combine numbers. The dude had like a 45-inch vertical. The dude is just a straight-up monster. Go look at the guy with his shirt off. I mean, he's 260-something pounds, and he gets to the quarterback in a heartbeat. The dude is just a monster, physical freak. I don't know that Freddie Bishop is that. So, you know, the way I'm looking at it is, yes, he seems like a nice player. He seems like he has a high motor. But if I'm looking at historical trends, I'm not seeing too many of these guys come in and have success. And he doesn't have the athletic traits that Cameron Wake did. So I don't think that the Wake comparison is really fair. But I would root for a guy like that because, honestly, you know, if it's between keeping a Trevor Riley who's good on special teams, and that's how Trevor Riley's going to make the roster if he does. It's going to be his special teams play. It's not going to be what contributions he's going to give you at linebacker. But if it's between keeping a guy like him or Freddie Bishop that he can come in on third down and give me something as an edge rusher, I'd rather have Freddie Bishop if he can be effective because you need guys that can rush from the edge to get to the quarterback. That's the name of the game in the NFL. That is how the Denver Broncos won the Super Bowl. They certainly didn't win it because of Peyton Manning. They won it because Von Miller and DeMarcus Ware just played insanely good at the end of the season. You know, so that's the name of the game, getting to the quarterback on third down, forcing them to make an errant pass because you know that they're passing on said down. So I'd rather see him, but I just don't think that it's going to happen.
Looking at the measurables right now between Freddie Bishop and Cameron Wake. They're the same height. They're both 6'3". Cameron Wake has a considerable more amount of weight on him. It's probably more muscle than it is weight. Cameron Wake's 270, and Freddie Bishop, at least the last time he weighed in, that was in Canada with the Calgary Stampede, he was 255. I mean, that could have gone up. I'm sure he's been hitting the gym with the gyps. So same height. He's just got a little bit more bulkier, and I'm reading his scouting report right now. He's got a high motor. He's got a good nose for the football, but the only thing that they have bad about him is that he doesn't have short area explosion, which is big as an outside linebacker. You need to have short area explosion, but I think Todd Bowles can definitely work on that. A lot of people don't give Todd Bowles the credit that he deserves as a defensive coordinator. I think he's the best one in the league, so I think he can work a lot of magic with a lot of guys. But we spent a lot of time on the linebacker position. Let's go into the secondary, and I'll just list them off all together. Darrell Revis, Calvin Pryor, Marcus Gilchrist, Marcus Williams, Buster Screen. Then as backups, I have Dee Milliner, Deion Bailey, Rontez Miles, Daryl Morris, and Justin Burris. And on the practice squad, I got Doug Middletown.
Okay. You said that all really quick, so I'm going to read you off mine quick as well. I know that we have at least one disagreement here. Darrell Revis, okay. Marcus Williams, Buster Screen, Calvin Pryor, Marcus Gilchrist, Dee Milliner, Dexter McDougal,
yep.
Justin Burris, Rontez Miles, and I have Daryl Morris instead of Deion Bailey. You know, honestly, I don't get what the infatuation is with Deion Bailey. This guy, he came in from the Seahawks.
I have Daryl Morris, too.
I know you do, so I'm trying to figure out who else, you
okay.
know, maybe you have one more guy in the secondary than I do. But I don't get the obsession with Deion Bailey, and I'm not saying that you're obsessed with him, but you know, a lot of Jets fans are really behind him, and I think one of the reasons is because, you know, he goes to these charity events, you know, he's going to paddle battle, he's going to all these types of things. So, no doubt, I think he's a nice player, he's on Twitter, he's on social media, but the guy came in, I wasn't overall impressed with his play, I saw him get smoked a couple times in the Jacksonville game, and he was hurt for a good portion of the season, so I really didn't see too much contribution from him. So I think that the Jets, and another thing that you got to look at, too, is he's a safety. Well, Marcus Gilchrist played 99.5% of the snaps. Calvin Pryor also played a high percentage of the snaps. Rontez Miles is the clear three. Now, you need more corners than you do safeties, and corners are more valuable than safeties. You can never have too many corners. Just look at Denver. They had Aqib Talib and Chris Harris. That didn't stop them from going out and drafting Bradley Roby in the late first round. So you can never have too many corners. Corners are more valuable. Justin Burris, a fourth-round draft pick, someone that the Jets had high on their board, best believe that someone like him is going to take precedent over a less valuable Deion Bailey.
Just a quick question. How many players in the secondary do you have in total? Because I have 10. I have six cornerbacks and four safeties.
I have 10 as well. So,
okay.
Let's see.
You said Dexter McDougal.
Yes.
I don't have him. So who did I have instead of him? Did you have Deion Bailey?
No, I don't have Deion Bailey. So that's
okay,
our disagreement right there. So you think that Deion Bailey, a guy that they claimed off waivers from Seattle that was injured for large portions of last year, to me, can you think of a single play where this guy flashed last year?
I know he did pretty decent in Miami, against Miami in London. I saw some good things out of him, especially in the red zone. I was pretty happy with that. I believe it was against Jordan Cameron. Is that the name of their tight end, or is it Cameron Jordan? I always
Jordan Cameron. Cameron Jordan is the pass rusher from the Saints.
So Jordan, I saw him break him a pass in the back of the end zone. It was like 3rd and 12 or something. And it was a very good play for him. And then the picture after, they're like the no-fly zone because they had a really good game. I saw good things out of him. Then he got injured. And I could say the same thing about Dexter McDougal constantly being injured. I just don't see an upside with that guy, unfortunately. I don't like him as a person, at least from my experiences with him. I feel like he's been kind of mean to people on social media, at least from
really?
What I've seen. I've seen him go to a couple events, some charity events, and that kind of makes up for it. But, you know, actually, social media makes a lot of people friendly with players and, you know, fans of players. The whole Fitzpatrick sensation probably wouldn't have been happening without social media. And when guys definitely like stuff and they do interviews and, you know, they go out and make an effort in the community, definitely makes a difference. Deion Bailey has been doing that. And honestly, I just like him better than Dexter McDougal. Dexter McDougal is constantly injured. I think we've given him ample opportunities. And personally, I'd be gone with Dee Milner too. But he's got a $4 million cap hit, and it's going to hit us either way. So I'd rather keep him on this team, hopefully stay healthy, and make him earn that $4 million and make him earn next year's contract, because we didn't pick up his contract for next year. So that's just why.
Yeah, I mean, and the reality is that I think that McDougal has certain traits. He's got good ball skills. There's no doubt about that. You know, he was an interception machine in college. He's pretty decent on special teams, and that's going to be one of his calling cards as well. I certainly have seen more of him on special teams than I saw of Deion Bailey. So, but again, he's a third-round draft pick, which gives him value, but you have to understand he was an Idzik guy. So Mike Maccagnan does have no ties to him. So I wouldn't be shocked if McDougal is cut. But if I have to say McDougal versus Deion Bailey, I will take McDougal.
Okay, we'll just have to agree to disagree. And quickly, we'll wrap up with special teams because I know we got one or two callers left on the line, and that's Gangrene David. He'll be our cleanup for tonight. He's usually our biggest hitter. Special teams, I'll just go up by position. My punter, Lachlan Edwards. Kicker, Nick Folk. Line specialist, Tanner Pundum. And kick returner slash punt returner, Jalen Marshall.
Okay. Now, I have Nick Folk making it as well. We're in complete agreement. I mean, I don't have Jalen Marshall, but in terms of Lachlan Edwards, Tanner Purdom, Nick Folk, we're in complete agreement. But I will say this. Nick Folk, I mean, this team is strapped for cash right now. We're talking about restructuring, guys. I mean, you're saying cut Breno Giacomini. They should have cutted him yesterday. That's what you're saying. You know, and we look at it like, you know, one of the things that they did was they gave Ryan Fitzpatrick avoidable garbage phony year next year, which the contract is going to avoid. Now, why did the team do that? So that they could save cap money this year, save a cap hit this year. So the team is totally strapped. Now, if the team wants to save some money, they could cut Nick Folk. And if I'm not mistaken, John Idzik is the guy that gave Nick Folk the contract, not Mike Maccagnan. And let's be honest about Nick Folk. I think he's a little bit overrated. People are going to remember him for hitting a 56-yarder to beat the Dallas Cowboys on September 11th. They're going to think about him hitting a 40-something yarder to beat the Colts in a wild card round of the playoffs. There's no doubt he came up clutch in certain situations. But what people are so easy to forget is the fact that this guy, throughout his career, both with the Cowboys and the Jets, he shanked the easy ones, the ones you're supposed to make, the 40-yarders and below. He shanked those, and those are often overlooked because they're not at the end of games. People always remember a kicker if he's going to shank one at the end, like, for example, what happened out in Minnesota in the playoff game against the Seahawks. You don't forget that. But when that same kicker shanks a kick in the first quarter, it's easy to forget because it wasn't a clutch kick. But he does this, and those kicks add up. There's still 3 points on the scoreboard, and if your team is playing catch-up all game, well, what does that say for you? So if Ross Martin is performing almost at the same level as Nick Folk or at the same level, you best believe that Mike Maccagnan is saying, hey, listen, we could go with the younger guy who wasn't hurt last year who's also going to save us cap money. So it's just food for thought. I have Nick Folk currently, but I would not be shocked if it's Ross Martin.
All right, and with that, we're going to go to our last caller of the night, and let me just find his music real quick. And warning to everybody, all right, his music is very loud, so if you're listening to this live, you turn down your microphone, and here it comes, Kyle, this applies to you too. All right, David, you are on, man. Welcome to the Jet Take. What's up? And David, are you there?
What's up? What's up, Kyle? How
are
you doing? I'm a little bit peeved that you and Ben pranked me earlier, but I'm doing good. Thanks for asking.
Yeah, thanks for being on. We'll have to talk about that later. So I know you were celebrating with your mom. Yeah, I know you were out celebrating with your mom for her birthday. Tell her happy birthday for us from here at the Jets.
I will. I appreciate that.
Even for Ben. I don't know if you were listening to us like the past. I don't know if you were listening to us like the past 15 minutes. We were basically yelling over our depth chart. But we'll just go over quickly a couple topics because we only have a couple minutes left. And, you know, we figured that we'll save the best for last because, honestly, you are our best caller. Sorry to the other callers, but Kyle, you're the host for this week, so it doesn't apply to you. But, David, would you consider having Quincy Enunwa as our starting tight end over Jason Mara?
That's a good question, but the thing I like about Quincy Enunwa, he's a great run blocker, and that's why people consider him a tight end. But I would see him as a receiver because he's really more explosive in that area, and that's kind of one of the key players in a player who catches the ball. So, I don't know. I would just stick to Quincy Enunwa blocking the run as a receiver or for the run. You get what I mean.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely a good point, and we'll just keep going rapid fire here. This is a question me and Kyle kind of have a disagreement here on the death chart. Would you rather keep Deion Bailey or Dexter McDougal?
That's a good question, too. If you saw Dexter McDougal, he went off during training camp today.
He also got injured.
Deion Bailey.
Again.
Deion Bailey, he played more snaps than Dexter McDougal. I saw him make more plays throughout last season. I wouldn't be surprised if Dexter McDougal got cut because actually, if I was Mike McGagnon, I would cut at least one of the corners. We have so many of them, but I wouldn't be shocked if Dexter McDougal got cut. I like what Deion Bailey would do. I think he could excel as a Jet.
Thank you, David. Next question. What is your take on the whole Ryan Fitzpatrick thing? I know you have this high aspirations for the Jets. We won't say what your high aspirations are. We just don't want to get into. We don't want to get into that now. But what's your opinion on the Ryan Fitzpatrick signing?
Well, first of all, I don't want to have to listen to your pessimism tonight. No offense, nah, but I love you, Kyle. But second of all, I'm stoked Ryan Fitzpatrick came back. I really am. He's a great QB for the Jets. Chan Gailey made him into the productive QB he is, and now he's going to walk in. The entire offense is upgraded, new running backs, an explosive Brandon Marshall, who, of course, really wanted him back. And then you have a solid Eric Decker and a returning Chase Morrow. When Ryan Fitzpatrick got signed, I was very excited. I mean, lots of Jet fans wanted him. He's my quarterback. He's a lot of Jet fans' quarterback. And personally, I can't wait to see what he does this year for the Jets. I really can't.
All right, I think that's how most Jets fans feel, even though the majority of them were Geno fans yesterday. But what do you think of the Tom Hasek getting waived and Lachlan Edwards basically being considered our starter now? That's the punter position.
Wait, I'm sorry. Repeat that again, Kyle.
What do you think of Tom Hasek getting waived and Lachlan Edwards basically being our starting punter?
I'm not surprised because I looked at Lachlan Edwards' stats over him. I would consider him a good punter for the Jets, especially he would be better than Ryan Quigley. Like what you and Ben said about him a couple of weeks ago, I agree with you guys. I personally think Lachlan Edwards could be a good punter for the Jets, definitely. And personally, that would be a smart situation.
And I think we're losing him here, Kyle.
Yeah, David, I don't know. I think I heard on a previous podcast that sometimes, like, when you call from your room or something, you got bad signal. So I don't know if you can move to a different part of your house.
I'm in my living room right now, and it should have good signal. Do you guys hear me?
Now you're clear, but before you were cutting.
I can hear you now.
All right. I'm good.
So what were you saying before? Can you repeat that?
Yeah.
I was saying... When Kyle, when you and Ben were talking about Lachlan Edwards last week, I actually agree with you. I watched his highlights, and personally, I think he would excel as a Jet, and it just doesn't shock me that he's starting. I knew he would start anyway.
Yeah, I mean, I think when you look at – go ahead, Kyle. Just go ahead and look at Tom Hackett's highlights, and it's that rugby style punting where, you know, you catch the ball, you sprint to your right, hold it for a couple seconds, then you kick it. Now, the reason why you hold it for a couple seconds before you kick it is you give your gunners a chance to get downfield to make the tackle. Now, that's done a lot in college, but that's not done in the NFL. So Hackett doesn't have a lot of hang time on his punts, which is something that's really valuable because you give the returner basically no ability to return it. Now, one thing that Lachlan Edwards has is maybe he didn't have the same type of yardage numbers that in terms of how far the ball traveled. But the reality is those balls went higher up, thus having more hang time, thus resulting in more fair catches. So his style of punting is more apt for the NFL than Tom Hackett's. And the reality is that he was a seventh-round pick. Tom Hackett was a priority free agent. So obviously the draft pick is going to take precedent anyway. So I don't think that too many people are really shocked that Hackett was waived.
Yeah, I would agree. All right, David, go ahead and give us your Twitter and Instagram and your YouTube. You run a great YouTube channel. I believe that's just Gangrene David, youtube.com/gangrenedavid. You guys should definitely go check it out. David, go ahead.
I'm sorry, I lost you a little bit, but I might as well just give out my info anyway. My name is David. I've been a Jet fan since 2011. My YouTube channel name is Gangrene David. It's just been straight vlogging about the Jets. I have a lot in store for the season. I can't wait. Of course, I had you and Ben on my YouTube channel. Yep. I had your other caller, Rumi, on, and I had the producer. I had your friend Kevin, Let's Talk Jets, on. Knowledgeable Jet fans you guys are. I appreciate that. You can follow me on Twitter, at GangreneDavid1. You can follow me on Instagram, at Gangrene_David, and I want to thank you guys for all your support for my YouTube channel. I really appreciate it, and just continue it. I love your podcast, guys. Well, even though Ben's not here, I love the podcast, and, you know, I'm just going to be calling it a lot because I love talking to you guys. It's nice. And this goes for Ben, too.
Yeah, the feeling's mutual, man. Thanks for calling it.
No Thanks, problem. David. Appreciate it, man.
Nice meeting you, Kyle.
Feelings mutual, man.
All right, so that was a great call for David, and unfortunately, we are already running out of time. Man, these 2 hours go by fast, don't they, Kyle?
Oh, yes. But that's what they always say. It's that age-old adage that time flies when you're having fun. And when we're talking about a team that we're so passionate about, we all want to be as optimistic as David and see our Jets win the Super Bowl. And that's why we're here talking about it, because we're talking about what can this team do to be better so that they can eventually win a Super Bowl. And when you get caught up having fun, the time just seems to fly.
Absolutely. All right, Kyle, I would like to thank you personally for coming on this week. We kind of gave you short notice here since Ben flew over to Europe and decided to ditch us. So thank you for being on. I really enjoyed having you on this week. So go ahead and promote all your social media and your podcast. You run a great podcast with your brother Gary, who unfortunately is a Bills fan. But just thank you again for being on, and go ahead and promote everything.
Unfortunately. Show them some mercy, though, because the Buffalo Bills never won a Super Bowl. But I appreciate that, Kyle. My podcast is the AFC East Bros Podcast. We run a live show very similar to this show, but we are on Tuesday evenings from 6 to 8 p.m. That is Eastern Standard Time. You want to call into our show, that is 712-451-0011. The PIN number is 321-848. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, all that kind of good stuff. Also find some videos on YouTube. We do some non-live shows as well, but those aren't as often as the live shows. You can follow me on Twitter at AFC East Bros, and my brother is AFC_EastBroGary. He loves getting into debates with Jets fans, so why don't you give him a follow? And oh, and by the way, it is his birthday tomorrow, so go and give him a follow. That'll be a nice birthday present for him. And I want to thank you so much for having me on. And, you know, I was standing on the shoulders of giants, you and Ben Blessington. It's not easy filling. Those are some big shoes to fill for Mr. Blessington. So I'm honored that I got a chance to try to do that.
Well, we're honored you agreed to have on the show. And once again, thanks for being on.
Thank you, Kyle.
All right, and I'm going to go ahead and promote all of our social medias right now. And once again, thanks to Kyle for being on. You can follow the Jet Tank on almost anything. I have to put on my glasses to read this. I don't really have glasses. I'm just trying to make a joke here. But follow us on Twitter, at the Jet Tank. Follow us on Instagram, at the Jet Tank. We're on Facebook now. Yes, we are a 45-year-old woman who likes to eat brunch. Follow us on iTunes, or subscribe to us on iTunes, as I should say. Subscribe to us on Google Play, iHeartRadio, SoundCloud, YouTube. You can also catch us on Stitcher. I don't know necessarily how you subscribe to an account on Stitcher. We constantly do things on Periscope when we can't have a broadcast that day. And we are also on Libsyn. We have a Libsyn blog. I believe that's www.libsyn.com/thejettake, so go catch us out there. Thank you guys for having or listening to us, and I'd like to thank Kyle again for being on. I'd like to thank all the callers who called in. Ben will be back in 2 weeks' time, but next week we have the boss, Jay, from nyjetsfans.com as my co-host. And once again, thank you guys for watching, and we're going to leave you with the best chant in the NFL, and you know how it starts. Everybody, do it with me.